discussions on topics affecting Hawaii's youth, ohana, and community.
Aloha mai kako. Welcome to another episode of Kūkākūkā. My name is Venus Rosete-Medeiros, and I am the president and CEO of Hale Kipa. And with me today, I have Laurie Tochiki, who is now a, well, soon to be, senior advisor to EPIC, Ohana, and then also Delia Parker Ulima, who is the soon to be executive director of EPIC Ohana. So welcome, ladies. How are you?
Thank you. Good, Maika'i. Mahalo for having us.
Thanks for being here. We'll be talking about transitioning a legacy of leadership. And Laurie here has been a cofounder of EPIC Ohana, that is now 26 years old, and also served as its executive director for 12 years.
That's right.
Right? Mm-hmm. And Delia, how long have you been with EPIC Ohana?
So almost 15 years.
15 mm-hmm. years. And what positions did you hold?
So primarily the High Hopes Initiative Manager. So High Hopes oversees the work of youth engagement and youth voice, youth leadership board statewide, along with community partnership HUI. So yeah, it's been a great honor.
So you've been in that position for 15 years?
So I was for 14 and a half years. So I was hired on as a program manager, but I held that position for just a few months before this position became open, and I took that on, and it's been one of the great honors of my professional life, for sure.
I know. Like, I want to tap into Laurie's brain right now, because Laurie, this is like your baby.
It is.
Right?
It is like my baby.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell us a little bit about EPIC, first of all, mm-hmm. and then share with us, like, how it feels to be, like, really, really passing the torch on to someone else to take care of your baby for you.
Yeah. So EPIC was founded in 1998 after we had developed a model called Family Group Decision Making, or for Hawaii, EPIC is Ohana Conferencing. And I'm an attorney by trade, and I had the honor and the privilege of being with the court and the Department of Human Services when they were thinking about how might we make child welfare better for our families and our children. And so I, Arlena Livingston and I helped to create the model that's now known as Ohana Conferencing while I was working at the law school and doing other things. And we did the pilot, and after the pilot was successful, we decided to scale it to statewide. We decided it was really important that Ohana Conferencing be housed in a neutral nonprofit rather than in the judiciary or in the Department of Human Services, and so that it can be really a safe, neutral place for families. And so we founded EPIC Ohana. EPIC stands for Effective Planning and Innovative Communication.
Oh, wow.
Because we put the words on the table. What do we want to be? And we want to be EPIC.
I love it.
Yeah, but that was before EPIC was EPIC. You know, it was like an EPIC journey,
right,
or an
mm-hmm.
EPIC hero. And Arlena was the first executive director. She was until 2012. And when she retired, I was ready to retire as well. I was associate dean at the law school, at the WMS Richardson School of Law, where I first met Delia. And so we switched places. So I had been on the board, mm-hmm. she went onto the board, and I became executive director. So
wow.
It's been wonderful. It's been a wonderful blessing. And it is very much one of my children. And it was a little scary to step down, but it feels really good knowing that my baby is placed with Ohana, right? And so having Delia, and because we were so concerned about our values and our culture, in fact, we were more concerned about that than anything else, because we know we can train the finances and the, you know, the technical pieces of it, but you cannot train the culture and the values of an organization. So,
and the heart, right?
And the heart, absolutely. So passing it along to Delia, whew, big relief.
So with EPIC, I mean, what are your grandest moments? Like, what are those accomplishments that EPIC was able to achieve under your leadership?
Yeah. Well, so really growing this family group decision making is, of course, like our crown jewel and our mm-hmm. our main thing. But over the years, lifting up the voices of lived mm-hmm. experience, I think is the most gratifying and also the most, I'm calling it our secret sauce. So when Delia and her partner Jean Hamilton really took this idea of youth boards, so these are young people with lived experience in the child welfare system, so former and current foster youth, and we started to hear their voices. We started to hear their wisdom and make big changes in child welfare, you know? And
Can you give us an example?
Sure.
At least one of the changes.
Actually, I'll let Delia do that.
Okay.
Because she's lived it.
Yeah, so our youth boards, again, they're made up of young people between the ages of 14 and 26. And to join the board, they had to have just spent at least one day in foster care after the age of 14. And so we have boards on Kauai, Maui, East and West Hawaii, on Hawaii Island and Oahu. And so they bring, of course, a wealth of knowledge. One of the things, so let's talk about some legislation, so some policy reform.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So the first bill that they advocated for and that passed into law and was signed into law in 2013 was called the Voluntary Extended Foster Care Act. And so what that did is it provided voluntary support or care, foster care, up to the age of 21 for young people in foster care. And it had been done at that point in a number of other states, but it hadn't, I think Hawaii was about 12 or 13th, mm-hmm. the 12 or 13th state to adopt that, to pass that into law. But what it did is it provided a little more time. Because as we all know, if you've ever had a teenager, they're not ready to be on their own at age 18, right? Completely on their own.
Right.
Nor are they at 21, but that's another story. But at 18, to be on your own and financially have to provide for yourself, find a place to live, let alone the fact that if these young people are aging and out of care, that means they did not reunify with their family, their parental rights were terminated, and they did not find a permanent legal placement.
That's so scary.
Yes.
I mean,
yeah,
when I think about
imagine?
It, right,
mm-hmm.
it's scary for a young person, right? All of a sudden, I reach 18, and where most people would be happy, mm-hmm. right? Wow, I'm 18. I can imagine for someone mm-hmm. in that situation going, oh my gosh, 18 is coming up,
yeah.
and I'm not ready.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's like a cliff. They refer to it as a cliff, right? You're at the edge of the cliff. What do I do, you know? And so the reason why most of our children are happy, they're excited at 18, is because they have us.
Mm-hmm.
So they have freedom ahead of them,
right.
but they have that safety net.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why they can be excited, because
right.
mom and dad or Ohana or papa or grandma, you know, or aunties, uncles, cousins are going to be there to see them off to college
mm-hmm.
or help them with their first job or help them with their first apartment and be there to walk them down the aisle or whatever that may be, right? And that isn't the case, right, for an 18-year-old. And not only are they having to figure out where they're going to live, how they're going to live and survive, but some of them might have children.
Mm.
Many of mm-hmm. them are, you know, unfortunately in the foster care system, many of them have been medicated, right? So they're dealing with the impact of PTSD. They suffer from PTSD 6 times more than the general public and even twice as much as someone who's experienced war or in the military. And so
it's
tremendous.
Just to get our audience to understand the impact of the how traumatic mm-hmm. it would be for you to be taken out of mm-hmm. your home, right? And mm-hmm. I can only imagine the impact it has on them as a young person growing up, like, what did I do wrong?
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Absolutely.
And the disruption that many of our young people have experienced in their childhood, which is that trauma, often they've gone to different schools because mm-hmm. maybe their family's been unstable or maybe homeless. And so that school instability mm-hmm. as well means that they're less likely to go to further education, which we all mm-hmm. know is so important, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But even our own children when they're 18, you know, how do you get an apartment? You have to have somebody sign for you if you don't have a good credit score. So even with that extended ohana, it's difficult.
Mm-hmm. Right. I remember when I had to go say goodbye to my, sending off my children to college, right? Mm-hmm. All three of them, that my bio kids who chose to go to college, I cried so much, yes. Like after on my leaving, right? Yes. And I was so worried about them. Like, you know, I can imagine like how they themselves, well, you know, they're surrounded by their friends or whatever, but for a young person to be able to, you know, go through that alone,
yes,
in a lot of cases, right? Not having that, like as you mentioned. So what did this extended, voluntary extended foster care provide for them?
Sure, and today it's called Imuakako, and the young people renamed because they said, we don't like the name. Let's not
extended
just,
care. You know,
let's not call it that, but let's call it Imuakako.
So
which
we call means?
It, moving forward together.
Hey.
Yeah, moving forward together, and IK for short. But it, what it provides is it provides some monetary support every month, a monthly stipend, if you will, or payment to live.
Like a living allowance kind of
yes,
thing?
Yes, yes. The term escapes me that we use for that that payment. But that monthly payment, it actually is the same amount that a resource caregiver or foster parent receives to care for a child or an adolescent child, because there are skills, I think. And that amount is what goes to them to be able to live, to eat, to pay rent, whatever they need to, as well as a case manager with on Oahu with Hale Kipa. So they're independent living providers.
Yay,
Hale Kipa! Independent living providers that actually help them. So help them apply for jobs, help them apply for scholarships or FAFSA if they're going to school. Help them make sure they're applying for all the resources out there possible. And on Oahu, it's Hale Kipa. In Maui County, it's Maui Youth and Family Services. On Kauai, it's in Kauai County, it's Hale Opio. And then on Hawaii Island, Salvation Army holds the contracts. So they provide that case management support for young people up through age 21. Mm-hmm. But to receive that monthly payment and that support, or remain in IK, if you will, there are requirements. So they have to either be finishing up high school, right, or some sort of a diploma. Or part or full-time in school, college, trade school, vocational school, or working part-time, 80 hours a month, so 20 hours a week or more, or working towards getting employment, or if they're medically disabled or deemed medically disabled, they can also. So there's requirements, but they're pretty broad, because we know that young people that are transitioning out, they might try something and maybe that doesn't work out, like school, and they need other options. So we don't want them to just fall off just because they're not pursuing college right now, for example.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that experience of seeing those voices from the young people has grown into several other things that I'm very proud of. So in terms of highlights, if you will, on the youth side, a whole cadre of our young people are now youth partners with the Child and Adolescent Mental Health Division.
I love that. Mm-hmm.
So our young people who have experienced so much in their lives, right? Some grief from loss, but also anxiety disorders, and Delia had mentioned PTSD, so lots of things that happen when your life has been disrupted. But they can walk alongside young people who are experiencing social and emotional disorders and challenges being served by the Department of Health. And so that youth partnership just helps them engage. It helps the young people just feel safe, you know. And for somebody to say, "Yeah, I think I know a little bit about what you're going through," and they can share. And then from that, we also have developed parent partners. Mm-hmm. So parent partners are adults with lived experience as birth parents in the child welfare system. So that means that they have encountered their own difficulties and had their children either removed or a part of the child welfare system. And they are just amazing.
I can imagine.
Parents, and again, you know, if a child is taken away, if your home is in crisis, or if you know you're facing really difficult legal issues, to have somebody who can just show up and respect you and
empathize and with empathize. The fact that they've gone through it as well,
exactly.
Right? So it's not like, you know, someone just out of a textbook trying to say the right things to this person. Yeah. It's like, from my lived experience, this is what helped me.
Yes.
And
and also gives hope.
Yeah.
You know, here's somebody who's walked this walk, and it's, I have hope now. So one of the different programs that we have parent partners is called Makua Allies. So these are women who experienced perinatal substance use disorder. That means they were struggling with a substance use disorder while they were pregnant. And so really difficult, challenging things because of the health of the baby as well as their own health. And so these Makua Allies help the mother stabilize, help them when they're in the hospital delivering.
Wow.
And have been successful in allowing those mothers to take their babies home, which is
so
not,
this,
you know.
So these services are offered like on every island?
No, so these, it's pretty new, but I'm really excited about and proud that we are growing the voices of lived experience, but it's still pretty new. Funding is kind of, you know how funding is in nonprofits. We go from this little grant and this demonstration project. So we're still growing it, but the results over the last two and a half years have been amazing.
So if a young person is watching and they say, you know, I have lived experience in the foster care system, what's the qualifications to become a youth partner?
So there's some age requirements.
Okay.
So we want a young person, not too old. So if they're like 30 already, then it's kind of hard to be considered a young person, especially other young people in, you know, they looking at, so you want somebody who's still under 27 with lived experience in a system. So it could be that they experienced homelessness or, you know, social emotional challenges, like, you know, at the Department of Health, foster care. Could be that they were a part of the juvenile justice system. So those kinds of lived experience, you know.
Oh, okay.
And we actually have openings right now, especially for Maui.
So they get paid?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes, they get paid. They get paid more than minimum wage. I wish we could pay even more, but
right.
And we treat our people with lived experience as professionals. They get a lot of training and support.
They travel.
And benefits, and they travel.
Very often they travel.
Yeah, they go to the mainland to conferences.
They develop their professional skills.
Mm-hmm.
That's great on their resume.
Yeah.
And the team, the manager, the supervisor, and they have one another. And to see them grow, right, to see them in the community, at meetings, in work groups, on committees, what they bring to the spaces that they come to is just tremendous. And as you mentioned, Laurie, there's just some things you can't teach.
Yeah.
You know, and unfortunately, we don't necessarily, you know, we don't wish our young people to be a part of systems.
Right.
But the reality is that many of them are.
Right.
And so if that's the case, and there are systems in place because of these circumstances, then to have peer support, to have someone that gets it, to have that connectivity, that empathy, and that and offer that hope and guidance is, it's a game changer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We really Imagine. Want our young people who have experienced, and our parents who have experienced these challenges, to heal.
So that's great. I love hearing that. So what... So, okay, so I'm a young person, I have experience, I go to apply. What are you looking for?
You know, there's a lot of intangibles, right? So they have to have graduated from high school. That's one
okay.
thing.
Okay.
But we're really looking for that ability to communicate and connect, that ability to have empathy, right? And also, I think more than anything, and this is true for all of our employees, lived experience or not, we're looking for that compassion and that sense that your life purpose and EPIC's values and purpose line up.
Line.
Because when they line up, then we're all happier. You know?
Okay, so it's not like they have to like have achieved major milestones in their life in order to be a youth partner.
Or a parent partner. And you know, often our young people and our parents are still struggling.
Yeah.
They're still struggling with you know, the aftermath of things. And that's why we have to provide the support, especially when they get placed in situations that may feel a lot like their own experience and may still bring back, you know, emotions and
some triggers.
Or activation of some kind.
I have met a few of your youth partners and your parent partners, and they are amazing. They are amazing. Like when they speak, you know it's coming from that place of, yes, I've been there. And what I love about them is that they offer like some really great mana'o, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because they have gone through it, and it's not like they're like mad at the system. It's like, hey, I was part of it, and this is what I've learned, and this is where I think we should be heading.
Very
and I love that about them. I wanna go back to the parent partners, because I think it's incredible to hear them share their story. Some of them have lost their kids and never really got to reconnect once again. And then there's some that was able to get back their children, and how they encourage each other and to be a part of like this greater global kind of world that they're traveling, they're sharing their voice with others out there, and they're contributing to the system and how the system can better support families. I love that. For a parent partner, what are you looking for in a parent partner?
Same thing. So they need a high school diploma. Although we've helped people get that GED. We're looking for that lived experience, and we're looking for people who are ready to take on that, really that leadership role, the leadership of their own lives, but to help have that voice for others as well, right? So just that willingness and that passion and that feeling of wanting to give back. In fact, those are kind of the magic words, that sense that, in fact, I heard this last night when we were doing one of our Malama Ohana community meetings, where one of our parent partners said, I'm blessed to be here. I am, by the grace of God, I am here. And now it's my turn to give back. And and that's the key. And I just want to share, too, that it's been such a blessing to be with Epic Ohana. We are a very special organization. And I think that is something I'm very proud of, that we do have an organization of people who are really committed to our families and young people who work really hard, but also support one another. And that's true for our lived experience, but it's true for all of our organization. In fact, I've worked in several different organizations, and this is by far the most loving, the most like an Ohana that, you know, that I've ever experienced.
Well, I can say the same for Hale Kipa.
Well, I've never worked for Hale Kipa.
I know. But I feel like we are like sister organizations.
We
you
are,
know?
Very much so.
We work very closely together. I think we share similar values.
Which is so important. And we other organizations that we consider sisters as well, and I think that's the other key, is that we work together, you know, for our families and young people.
Right. Yeah. So Delia, here you are, like, you know, as Laurie has kind of built this organization to where it is today, because I know it didn't happen overnight. It took time, right, to build this and to get those bills passed and to get, like, all of the things that our young people have fought and advocated for. Right, the changes in our system. And here we are now, we're still trying to improve child welfare system. So one of the things I really want to be clear about is that the people who work in child welfare services, are good people. You know, they live here in Hawaii, they're contributing to the betterment of our community, but they're working under a system, right, that doesn't necessarily always have the policies and procedures in place that is best aligned with our community and where we want to be and what really our families need. And so part of the work of Malama Ohana, since Laurie brought that up, is really about looking at the system overall and what can we do to make it more appropriate, better aligned to our community values, our Ohana values, that can serve our families even before they get into the system, right? So to walk alongside with us in this field in preventing families from even getting into the system. And then if they do have to get into the system, how are we supporting them to be successful so that they can get out of the system and live a successful family life with their children? Because we all know that as much as our children, I mean, we can provide a safe place, we can provide shelters for them, services for them, the best place is really at home for them to be, but to be in a healthy, safe home environment. And the only reason why we would want to maybe remove a child is when that isn't so for them, when it's not a safe or loving home, right? But we can work with the families. So I think EPIC and Hale Kipa is working very closely in trying to see that happen. We're offering these community services to hear community voice for others with lived experience so we can better come together and create a list of recommendations that we can offer our legislators. But anyway, going back to Delia. Delia, how do you feel about now, you know, getting this organization under your leadership as the person, you know, who's going to be at the helm?
The helm. Well, see, we're talking story, right? There was an article, right? I forget which organization, which was it Hawaii Business? Do you remember they did that article on you years ago and they mentioned you're at the helm?
Oh,
and,
did it?
And you're like, helm? I can't even see myself at the helm. Anyway, I'm a ship. You think
I'm a
ship.
Big ship.
Kind of like a Titanic. You know, maybe not the Titanic. That's not
the one analogy.
We don't want it to be the Titanic. I mean,
maybe the QE2.
Yeah. QE2, there you go. I mean, you know, I was going to say there are no words, but there's lots of words. The first word that comes to mind, Venus, is I'm tremendously humbled and grateful. I'm excited. And I really, you know, when I was informed that the board selected me, I don't know how to explain that feeling of that came over me. It's to awamo that kuleana. Awamo is like to put on that mantle of responsibility, right? I felt that and I feel that now, and I understand that there's a transition that will take place. And so Laurie, our board's foresight to have Laurie remain as a senior advisor and consultant for, you know, a duration of time, to help with that transition, the board themselves putting together pieces for them to support me. So, because in supporting me, they're supporting EPIC and families and children and our partners, right? So that's the EPIC way. So I am tremendously grateful for that. It is not something that everybody gets or receives. And so I want to acknowledge that, that foresight, the kind of consideration that was taken into place and planned for months when Laurie decided last year that it was time and had given that kind of, that time, that year.
And getting some new mo'opuna kind of help with that decision.
Oh, yeah, that was a little incentive.
Having grandchildren always incentivizes.
Right. Yeah, two little cuties,
So you'll be able to spend more time.
And
just tremendous to awamu that kuleana. You know, I'm cognizant and of the fact that the 105 part and full-time staff members of EPIC Ohana that live across Hawaii, that serve statewide, right? This is this is what puts food on the table for them. This is also, for many of them, their heart work, their life work, their passion, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Especially those with the lived experience. Everybody at EPIC, I truly believe they're there for a reason,
right.
And they stay for a reason. And particularly those with lived experience, right?
You know,
this
is
their life work.
I call it a calling. I think it's
yes,
a calling,
it is.
Right?
It is a calling.
To do
it's
this kind of work, it's
yes.
really a calling.
Mm-hmm. It really is. It really mm-hmm. is. Mm-hmm. I want to share that we really did work very diligently, the board and myself and our leadership team, in preparing for this. So before a year ago, we created a leadership academy. So mm-hmm. we call it the EPIC Ohana Leadership Academy, EPIC Ola. Mm-hmm. And so we had one cohort of emerging leaders kind of working on what does it mean to be a leader? What's the difference between a manager and a leader? We understanding ourselves and our communication styles. And then this year, what we did was we took the managers and did a cohort, and we're still in that cohort. So working together, learning together, and then the leadership team also spent a lot of time thinking about what do we want from our next leader. Mm-hmm. And so they came up with a list mm-hmm. of nice to have to have, and deal breakers.
Don't want to have.
The list was on the wall. And
it was on the wall.
And
the deal breakers. And, yeah. and really what we decided together was that adherence to our values mm-hmm. and the heart was the most important thing. Mm-hmm. And so when EPIC hired Inkanen to do mm-hmm. the search, and we are very grateful that 41 amazing people did come forward.
Wow, that's great.
And they, you know, our board was very thoughtful and concerned but they listened to what the leadership team had to say about
that's
what
wonderful.
Was important. So it really has been all of us together. Yeah.
I love this. You know, the reason why I wanted to really highlight this mm-hmm. moment on Kūkākūkā is because I think there's a lot of organizations right now mm-hmm. that's going through this process.
Sure.
You yeah. know, and so there are some fears, there's some mm-hmm. excitement, and then the processes mm-hmm. that you took in order to select the person that you selected, I think people can learn mm-hmm. from that, right? Mm-hmm. So I love like what you said. The you know would be nice to have the ones have to
yeah,
have and the one
yeah.
I don't want to have right mm-hmm. like those kinds of stuff is really important to I remember when Delia can I get a little personal here
how personal yeah
she reached out to me yes. and she said can I talk to you and she was contemplating whether mm-hmm. or not she was going to apply mm-hmm. and it was like what do you think you know and I was like Delia I mean if there's that tugging at you mm-hmm. your heart then go for it I mean I saw that mm-hmm. leadership and that passion I mean the fact that you went to school become an attorney and you mm-hmm. ended up at EPIC and you stayed for 15 years right
yeah.
that says a
yeah.
lot about your commitment to the work, to the organization, and the accomplishments that you've mm-hmm. made in that particular program in empowering these young people to advocate. To today, we live in a different system now, right?
Mm-hmm.
In our youth,
yes.
our foster care system with our young people are different mm-hmm. because of that work. And I don't know if everyone, if you don't like live in this realm in social service field, really understand how much that means for the young people that we serve.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, you know what, I want to tap into, like, what was the fears that you had?
Well, had and you know, honestly, continue to have in some ways, not the same fears I had back then. And I you know, I'm not gonna necessarily call them fears right now because I think it would be crazy for a new executive director not to have concerns or some anxieties because there's a tremendous onboarding process that has yet to take place. So it keeps you a little sharp, right? Because it's so important to me because it's so important to so many people. So the fears. So let me. Do you mind if I step back just a little bit in time?
But absolutely. Not to go ahead.
So my first interaction with EPIC Ohana was as a foster parent. Mm. Right? So back, oh, he's going to be 22. He was 18 years ago. Yeah. Right? 18 or so years ago, I became a resource caregiver and attended an Ohana conference. And so that was my first interaction with Epic Ohana, not applying for a job. I didn't apply for a job till 2 or 3 years later, right, at Epic Ohana. I was a business owner, and a friend of mine was a guardian ad litem and reached out and asked if my husband and I were interested in becoming resource caregivers or foster parents. And anyway, long story short, we became, but that was my first interaction with Epic Ohana. And it was a wonderful experience. And so from a, for lack of a better term, consumer position in the community, I knew what it felt like to have the services reach out, have someone reach out, have someone schedule on a conference, sit through a conference, and the way they conducted themselves. And I had some concerns thereafter, and I called Epic, and I talked to the executive director. And she answered the call, and she spent time with me on the phone. You know, I'm not saying everyone call me. But you can. I mean, and it was Arlena Livingston. And she's the cofounder and the first executive director, and she's the one that hired me. Mm-hmm. So when it was time to close down my business and I was looking for something meaningful to do with my law degree and with my kind of passion for to serve the Lahui, right, and to serve children and youth, when I saw that, I said, oh, Epic Ohana's hiring. I felt right. It was divine time.
Yeah. Yes.
And so when this, yes. So let's fast forward then to last year, when we, as a manager, when we were part of the whole, okay, Epic, Lori let us know over a year ago, the managers, that this was gonna happen. And we started to walk us through. And you know what? Again, for those who are watching and you're considering or gonna go through an executive transition, this is really a blueprint, I feel, for how things are done well. They kept us in the loop, they meaning Lori and the board and senior admin at Epic from the very beginning. Every step, it wasn't just like, I'm retiring in a year and I'm out, see you later, like a year later. No, it was several meetings, it was discussions, it was emails, it was getting our Manaʻo feedback, it was sessions we had in person together. And so I had not even at that time considered applying. And I was part of that process of helping the board decide what to look for. So when I reached out to you in October or so, there are a series of things that happened, but all I can say is it was kind of a divine calling. I had some sort of a spiritual thing that happened where I felt like I should apply. And I also knew, and up until the moment that I got the call, that no matter who the board chose, I was fine with and I would support. Because I trusted that they had gotten to this process and that it was a process that they had considered everything. So I can honestly say I was fine with whatever the outcome was. I was at peace with that. And so I just wanted to share that.
Yeah, I love how you guys are doing this. Mm-hmm. You know, unfortunately, I didn't have that experience when I took on the CEO position for Hale Kipa. It was very abrupt. And having this smooth transition and the passing of the torch, I think is admirable, because I think for the sake of the organization, right, why wouldn't you want it to be a smooth transition? And then also that the staff sees that you're supporting Delia in taking on this role.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. I think it's important for them to observe that, like, wow, so Laurie is standing behind and is supporting Delia to kind of mentor her into this role, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's really important. You know, being in, once again, in a position that didn't quite happen with me, I had to find my way. And I think it was probably very questionable for the staff, like, wait, was she supported? Did they really want her in that position? Mm. And then, of course, you know, the things that I make up in my head, you know, because when you don't know, you make up stuff. And there was a lot of things that I was making up about me in this new role. and did they really want me, or they, you know, all kinds of stuff. So
wow.
I love how you guys are doing it, and I would encourage anyone who is out there who's looking at this transition, because I feel like we're in this moment. When you look at all the different new executive directors and CEOs who have come in the last couple years.
Yes.
It's a lot.
Well, and there are a couple reasons for that. One is that generally executive directors don't last 12 years or 14 years, right? I mean, at least on the continent, there's more turnover. But the biggest reason, I just turned 69. And so I'm a part of the baby boom, and my generation has been, we've grown to this leadership, right? And it's time for us. Mm-hmm. But you know when you said, this is your baby? Actually, it is my baby, but now it's a grown-up. And I'm very proud of how grown-up it is. And it's ready. It's ready, and it needs new leadership. I think that's the other thing that is so important, is like making sure the foundation is strong, and that it's almost like when my daughter got married, it's like, okay, you know, she's ready.
She knows.
I've done my part. She's good people. I also want to give a shout out to our board. So when we made the announcement, they made the decision, and then our board was there in the meeting with the leadership team first, and then came to our all hands meeting the next day. So that they could answer questions from the leadership team and express their support for all of EPIC on a, we called it a potluck, so it was a big Zoom potluck. And I think that also helped, that you know that they're behind us and in front of us and beside us.
It really is tremendous. Every step from the moment I got the call, even the communication plan, who needs to find out first? Who do we not just want to find out through the grapevine, right? Making that phone call to our biggest partner, who is child welfare, right? The leaders, and just being so considerate about that process. It's just a testament to the way EPIC does things that I'm proud to now represent as its executive director. Can I speak to really quickly back to a couple of the fears?
Yes.
So, and because for the new leaders coming up out there, especially the wahine, right? Mm-hmm. One is that I was hired, so there's only ever been two executive directors of EPIC Ohana in 26 years.
And I had two prior to me in 54 years.
That's
tremendous.
Pretty incredible.
Third. But and we're 54 years old.
That, the first woman.
Yeah,
first,
and the first woman
and first Kanaka.
Native point. So that is tremendous. So just like that, I'm the third, right? And they're both co-founders. They were both, and I was mentored by and worked under both. So in my mind, that's one of the reasons I had not even thought about, because I'm like, well, who am I? This is, right? I mean, you see yourself a certain way. You know, I knew my niche. I knew what I was good at. I loved doing it. That's why I stayed at EPIC so long. I was happy there. But Arlena and Laurie were, you know, that's who I looked up to. So that was difficult, because I thought about shoes to fill. But I shared this story, and it's, even though it was a conversation between between Laurie and myself, I also reached out to Laurie to kind of let her know, I think I'm going to throw my hat in the ring. And that's the only conversation I ever had with her about that. Mm-hmm. I never talked to her from that point until that was several months ago. And it was a 6-minute conversation. And it's right when I came back from the trip after I talked with you. And this is what she told me. She said, because I said, you know, big shoes to fill, all of that. Don't know if I can do it or if I should do it. And in her wisdom, because Laurie is a wise person, and not just because of her years, because this is who she is. But she said, you know, Delia, the leader that EPIC Ohana needed 20 years ago is not who it needs now, right? It's that next generation, and it's grown. It's a grown up. So my second fear that I had to overcome, and I will have to keep continue to overcome, is I'm a Native Hawaiian woman. So in my mind, you know Venus, right? I'm a Native Hawaiian woman, and there's another set of expectations and eyes on me in the community, whether we talk about it or not, that's real.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? if I were a male and maybe a different ethnicity, maybe or maybe not, I would be not scrutinized as much. I don't know. And I'm not even putting that out there because I'm fortunate to have built relationships. And so I hope that people that do know me in the system trust me and I can forge more relationships. But I'm cognizant because I've been a businesswoman and where I'm the only one in the room like me. Mm-hmm. Right? So that's another, when you're a Kanaka, that's a whole nother kuleana that kuleana. You awamo.
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. Yeah. And yes. No, I'm there, girlfriend. Mm-hmm. I am totally there with you. Like, I feel there's times when, you know, I question, like, even when I applied for Hale Kipa, I've been CEO now for a little over 2 years. And I remember when I was contemplating throwing my hat in the ring, mm-hmm. as you put it, I went through a whole series of like, why me? Like, should I do it? Da, da, da. And then it came to me, you know, like, who better than someone who is Kūkākūkā from this aina, right? Who understand the culture, who understand the people, mm-hmm. who've been in this field for 30s, over 35 years at that time, mm-hmm. now it's 38, right? Why not?
Yeah, why not? Mm-hmm.
You know, because I think sometimes we limit ourselves.
Yes.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
We're the ones, our own limiting beliefs, mm-hmm. they call it, right? Yeah. We tend to put that on ourselves. And it was like, you know, if I don't do it, what kind of role model am I mm-hmm. for my children, my daughters?
To even try, right?
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. If I don't.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so I did it really because of my daughters. Like, I wanted them to know that, you know what? You'll never know unless you try. Do it. Yeah. And I was completely surprised when I found out that there were 200 applicants mm-hmm. for this job. And to get it, I mean, you talk about not only feeling humble, but that sense of, I hear you, mm-hmm. that oamu and that kuleana mm-hmm. that comes with the position, right? And I embrace it full force, like, yeah, you know, because I know that the decisions that I make, everything that I do for Hale Kipa is gonna be a legacy. Mm-hmm. Right, that we yeah. set the organization, and you're right, Laurie. I'm a baby boomer too, you know. I just kind of
you're
made
that younger.
I made the
yeah.
cutoff.
Right
I made the cutoff, right?
Like the youngest baby boomer.
But I am a baby boomer, and I'm thinking, man, I only have like so many years left, right?
Yeah.
To like do everything that I can before I have the luxury of enjoying mo'opuna. Mm-hmm. My fingers are so you know, I think this is a sense of urgency too, at least
yes.
for me. I feel that sense of urgency to get as much as I can done. With the EK and the wisdom that I've learned through the years being in this field, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And but I also wanted to take the time, because I know our time is coming short, but I wanted to take the time, Laurie, to really mahalo mm-hmm. you. For the years of service that you've given our community, our families, our children. Oftentimes, you know, we're the ones behind the scene, and you have been behind the scenes that have pushed forward some great initiatives, including Malama Ohana, mm-hmm. including Nakama Ahaloa, mm-hmm. and all of those other things that EPIC is a part of because of your leadership, mm-hmm. but not necessarily the one that this is your program, but you guys have been the backbone.
Yeah, yeah.
Of these initiatives that's gonna change a lot of the system. Like we talk about systems transformation many times, but what is that, right? Mm-hmm. This is mm-hmm. that. Like to me, people talk about it
yeah.
all the time, but we're doing it.
Yes.
And like, can I say something about the backbone piece? And which I think is important for us in the community who seek systemic reformation, who says we want to do something big and bold, and we know that we need to reform things and systems and policies and changing hearts and minds. It's not the most glorious thing to be the backbone. And that's what EPIC has always been happy to be.
Yeah.
The facilitator, the convener, the relationship, the pilina builder, if you will. And so someone, I'm not going to share who because then they'll know what organization she was talking about. But she's like, sometimes people and organizations, and I won't even say organizations because I'm not going to put that, but people want to be the biggest pool in your hair. Everybody can see, oh, we did this, I did that, right? You want to be the biggest pool in the hair. And there's nothing wrong with a good big pool in your hair. I'm not saying that, but
a giant
hibiscus, right?
But or a bird of paradise.
Bird of paradise. It'll get much bigger than that or heavy. But with Epic, I'm so proud that Epic has always been happy to be the visionaries as well, but the ones that say, let's do it together. Mm-hmm. And to be the backbone and to put the people at the forefront that should be, and in our case, usually it's those with lived experience.
Right.
Yes. They're at the forefront. It's their voice that's uplifted. Right. And we're there to support and be a community support as well.
So, gosh, I know our time is coming up and I'm kind of bummed because I really want to get into this because you triggered something. You know, with all the stipulations, when you have state contracts and all of that, you cannot use someone who had a felony charge or someone was in prison for anything.
Child abuse and neglect. Child abuse and
neglect. Then child abuse and neglect and all of that. And then I'm going, but then the value, though, of their journey, being able to help support others, when we're given those kinds of criteria, like you cannot hire anyone like that, you got to do background checks and all of that, how do you get past that?
Well, and this is a really good point because, first of all, it took a little bit of perspiration. And we had to have a number of meetings, especially with our parent partners, right? Because under our contract, no one can have a child abuse and neglect background. But so we had to say, you know what? That's important for this position. That is exactly the expertise we need. And we had to kind of do a lot of explaining. And that's why the support is so important. So it took some really strong advocacy. And I'm proud to say that the last legislature passed another working group, this one to really look at peer support, to look at certification, training, but also to look at barriers and opportunities for embedding peer support. And I think that's going to be a really important thing. The other thing I want to say, Venus, is that I'm not Paul yet.
I know you're not Paul yet.
And even though I know for sure in my heart, and I'm very grateful that the work of EPIC is in good hands, I'm in there. I'm in there. I'm going to advocate. I'm going to.
Well, you cannot leave me. You cannot leave me with this
we're
whole
co-chairs.
Mama Ohana thing, right?
I'm not leaving. And there's a lot that can be done, and I am ready to do.
Awesome.
Yeah. So not Paul yet. Yeah. The babies are in Seattle. I will go and play with them whenever I can, but not Paul yet.
Yeah. Awesome.
You know, Laurie's a UH regent.
Yes.
Right.
She has a bunch of.
So. She's not going anywhere, right? But the good news is that you have the flexibility that if you wanted to, you could go somewhere for the weekend, like to visit your grandbabies.
Right? Yeah. Well, I'm going to let Delia take care of paying the bill, figuring out the budget.
People.
Okay. Yeah. So your hair can be like ours. See, Laurie has, she's like.
Yeah, I just let it go.
Yeah, but you know what? She's wearing it. She's like, owning it.
Crown of glory. Me, crown of glory.
If I don't color my hair, I'm gonna be like, I could be like that too, right? I just haven't done it yet. But Delia, I just want to welcome you on board too.
Ooh, is this a time?
Pretty soon.
Okay. I
want to welcome you on board as our newest executive director for EPIC, and welcome to. Yeah, this role.
World.
And I want to just commit myself to you. Not that
Thank
I have
you.
Anything to really teach you, but I'm here to support you 100,000%. And now this is the
so
moment. Drum roll.
We're passing the torch.
We're passing the torch.
I'm matching too.
Yay, it's official.
Thank you.
We have like a couple minutes left. Any last things you want to say?
Well, just thank you. Thank you for having us and for this opportunity to talk about our transition, but also to share. Mm-hmm. And you know what? For our families and children in Hawaii, this is exactly what I'm hoping for. We have the ability to have a Hawaii that loves its children and has families and children that thrive. And I think leaders like both of you are going to make that happen. You're exactly what we need. So I'm very excited and happy for Hale Kipa, for EPIC, but also for all the families and children in Hawaii.
Thank you, Laurie. How about you, Delia?
I'm just grateful that I get to build on a legacy that already exists because of people like Laurie and Arlena and those that have come before us. Our young people have our High Hopes boards. Their motto is leaving a legacy. And they really feel that as well. So if we can impart anything to the next generation, to that coming up, is that everybody has opportunity to create and leave a legacy. And so I say to everyone out there, especially our young ones, right? The question is, why not? Why not you?
Why not?
Chance them. Especially those that think I could never do it. You know, our wahine, our kanaka, or anyone out there, you've been part of systems. Why not? Do it.
What a great way to end this segment, and embrace that torch. I'll get burned now. And thank you for joining us in this segment of Kūkākūkā, and we look forward to you next time. Mahalo.